One person I'd like to introduce is William Vetter. He's the president and founder of Pangolin Laser Systems. Bill and I have been friends for many, many years and allies in a lot of areas, particularly in laser safety in general. It's with Bill's assistance that I was able to get an audience scanning variance, one of the first in the U.S. Specific to galvanometer scanning, low inertia scanners, as we'll talk about. And that took about 2 years, and we finally, and actually this was Bill's doing, had to go to the CDRH ombudsman to say, you guys are taking too long. Bill's company not only writes the best and most popular software for creating laser shows, but it works a lot on the safety side, making sure that things are inherently safe as best as can be. So, Mr. Vetter.
Introduction was very gracious and very kind. I thank you very much for attending to this. Greg introduced me as William Benner. I'm not Conan O'Brien, although I get accused of that very often. I've got a little presentation here, and I debated whether to put this at the beginning or the end of my thing. My presentation I'm going to be giving you is only hopefully about 5 minutes long, PowerPoint presentation. I know it's about 9 o'clock in the morning here in Las Vegas, and some people might have flown in or might have had a late night or something like that. And so I think I'll put this at the beginning of the presentation because it's pretty interesting. If you're not awake right now, rather than put you to sleep with the PowerPoint presentation, I think I'll try to wake you up with this little presentation right here. So what I've got here is a projector that's made in China. It may as well be any laser projector made in China because a lot of them are made in the same way. Of course, there's good laser projectors made in China and not so good ones. This one here is a 300 milliwatt white light projector, which costs only $250. So it's very accessible to anybody. And so because of its low price, it's very attractive. So when I first turn the power on to this here, I'm just going to plug the power in, and what you're going to see for a brief moment is a static full power beam before it goes into its own little built-in pattern projection thing. Now, this is a very common product and very common for projectors made in China to have pattern projectors built inside of them. And it's kind of handy because it's basically goes through its own little pattern here that's switchable and selectable on the back. You can connect DMX to the projector to control it with a lighting board. But more interesting to all of us here is that it has this ILDA connector on the back so that you can plug just a more powerful laser software into it, such as the stuff that we make. Now, the interesting thing is this. The way that it knows whether to be controlled with external software or to be producing patterns with its internal pattern projector is it has this little sensor basically on the connector so that when you plug the connector in, it knows that, well, I shouldn't use the internal pattern projector anymore. I should use the software instead. Now, what I have just plugged in here through this ILDA cable is our FB3. It's the least expensive hardware that we make. And what just happened is exactly what you would expect to happen. I connect the external controller, and nothing comes out of the projector. And as soon as our software starts putting something out, then that's what would be coming out of the projector. But what happens when something goes wrong? So think about this. Here's a laser hardware controller made by a competitor, and watch what happens when I plug the competitors in. What we get out is a full power static beam. And the reason is because the lasers inside this projector are something called TTL lasers. This is very common for Chinese projectors. What TTL basically means in the form of a laser is that the laser's either fully on or fully off. The reason why TTL lasers are found in a lot of Chinese projectors is because a lot of them are lower cost, and so they have lower power lasers inside. And so by using TTL lasers, they're either on or off. It's an artificial way of making the projector seem brighter. The problem with TTL lasers in many cases is they do something called floating high. So that means when you disconnect the signal going into the laser, it becomes on, not off. And so when this has switched its internal signal from the pattern projector to the external signal, it switches the TTL lasers to be controlled by this. The TTL lasers float high, and since most electronics, when you take the power off of them, when you turn the power off, the electronics kind of goes floppy. It becomes lifeless. It becomes as though it's disconnected. So even though the projector senses that something is connected to the cable, everything's powered off in this box, and so the box is lifeless. It's not really pulling down these signals, so you get full brightness signal out. Now, the way it works with ours is we use special components in our FB3. We knew this was a problem. So we use special components. The components that we use in here are made by only two companies in the entire world. Since there's low supply, it means that due to the supply and demand, there's higher prices. So we had to pay good money to put this feature into our software, into our hardware. And so, you know, what I'm saying is that we are very safety conscious. One of the things that we run into when Greg and I go up to CDRH is they don't want to hear all the features we have and what's working when everything is going right. What they want to know is, what does it do when something goes wrong? And so it's really a different mindset of fail-safe design. This word fail-safe is really a word that's in the popular culture, and because of that, it tends to lose its meaning. What fail-safe means is that when something fails, it will fail in such a way as to become safer, not more hazardous. That's what fail-safe means. And we put this kind of design methodology, and when we're designing a piece of software or hardware, we're always thinking like this. What happens when something goes wrong? That's really a very important thing. So we talk about lasers. With respect to the discussion you're going to be having here, the class that Greg is going to be putting on, we're really talking about lasers in basically three different forms. Here's a picture that was taken in Australia, lasers in airspace. As you can see, these beams are at least projecting horizontally, if not up, into the air. Overhead beam effects, which we'll be seeing a lot in the next few days here at Lighting Dimensions International, beam effects projected over people's heads. And, of course, audience scanning. Now, Pangolin has a number of tools built into our software and that we sell in addition to this, which will help you in all three of these cases. The first one I'm going to be talking about is our beam attenuation maps feature. What this basically is a way in the software where you can reduce the power or even completely eliminate laser power in certain areas. This is a little screenshot I kind of mocked up in our Beyond software. What it shows you is that we have some areas here that are kind of curved where we don't want the laser to go. I put a couple of little boxes up in here. I'm sure Greg's going to be talking about lasers that might wind themselves up on a video projector. Even though it's projecting light, these video projectors are actually susceptible to lasers going back into the lens. It can hurt the video projector. Or these things could be video cameras on, you know, if you're in the Grammys or something like that where they have a lot of cameras around. So let's say you want to shoot the lasers around the camera space. That would be very exciting for the cameras to see it, but if the laser goes right into the camera, then it could be harmful. And so with our beam attenuation maps feature, you can prevent laser light from going into those areas. And also you can even create gradients. What you'll see is here it goes from a full power area down into an area of about 20% brightness. One of the things Greg's going to be talking about later is audience scanning and how this all works. It's pretty important to reduce the laser power that comes down into the audience. If you do that gradually, like you do here in our beam attenuation map feature, then it works pretty well. So this is in all of our software. It's even in QuickShow, the least expensive software, has essentially the same beam attenuation map capability as our most expensive software, which is called Beyond. And it's absolutely free. It's a built-in feature. It's not something that you pay for extra. And there's a lot of exclusive things about this to Pangolin. such as the ability to create curved areas, the ability to create gradients, and that sort of thing. The reason why these are exclusive, you might have heard of features like this in other software. They might probably call safety zones or something like that. But nobody has the degree of flexibility and power that we do because we patented this. We invented this in 2001. We patented this. And so the other guys, they don't want to get too close to our patent. And so they'll do some things kind of on the edges and that kind of thing. But nothing gives you the degree of flexibility and power that our beam attenuation maps has. Talk about another thing. I've heard before the class start that there's some interest in audience scanning, and I know Greg's going to be talking about this. This is something that you could put on a projector to help to make the projector safe. So what this does is it increases the divergence of the laser as it comes down to the audience, but gives full non-diverged, full power beams above the audience. And because of this, it gives a very immersive experience while also giving a very safe experience. There's several ways of doing this. You could put a dedicated lens in the entire laser projector, and that's kind of, in some ways, the safest way because the lens can't be removed, it can't fall out of the beam path. The bad news about that is that it affects all of the beams projected by the laser, whether they're projected above the heads or not. So the safety scan lenses, because it's a half lens, it only affects the beams below the horizon. If you have a laser projector that has some screw holes on the side of the exit aperture, this mount will go right there and allow you to attach that that lens to the projector. And if you don't, one of the things that we have as a retrofit situation here is little tabs that can be, this red strip is actually tape. It sounds very unsophisticated, it just doesn't sound like a safe scenario to be taping something on a projector. This is made by VHB tape. VHB stands for very high bond. There's a gentleman here from Lockheed. Are you familiar with VHB tape, sir? Yeah, so this is basically military-grade double-faced tape that cures in 72 hours, and 72 hours afterwards, it's going to be basically impossible to... This is a permanent fixture on the laser projector after 72 hours. So this is a very secure way. Even though these kind of things are exclusive to Pangolin, we don't use this as an opportunity to charge very high prices. The lens we charge $100 for, this lens mount is available for $29.95. So really, really affordable stuff to add to a projector. So this helps to make a projector safe. And this next thing called PASS helps to keep a projector safe. What PASS does is it monitors the entire internal behavior of a laser projector. It monitors the power supply, it monitors the laser, it monitors the shutter activity, it monitors the overall health of a projector, and if anything is going out of kilter, this thing will terminate the exposure either momentarily or permanently. It will forcibly turn off the projector to the point where you have to actually unplug it or press a reset button or something else like that. So this can work with TTL as well. Normally, this would be built into a projector, and Greg Makoff sells a line of projectors with PASS built into it. And so, if audience scanning in the United States is something you are interested in, I would encourage you to check out what Greg has to offer. Actually, what's more interesting and more important than hardware purchased by anybody, even somebody as reputable as Pangolin, is the variance. So just because you have this stuff built into your projector doesn't mean that you can automatically and instantly start doing audience scanning. You have to get variance for that, and that's something that Greg is very well versed in. So we're very fortunate that the laser industry, ILDA, has recognized our safety-related products. In 2002, we received the highest place awarded technical achievement award for projection zones, of which our beam attenuation maps are a part. In 2006, we received a first place award for PASS, and in 2012, most recently, we've received a first place award for our safety scan lenses. So we've been very fortunate that safety is really not the glamorous end of what we do. And so we were fortunate that the recognition was still there in these products. So as Greg mentioned, we've actually got a really long history of participation in the in field of safety. Greg Makov and I and Patrick Murphy have all given presentations at the International Laser Safety Conferences. We have given invited presentations at the FDA, the CDRH, both individual personal meetings with the top people there, and also something called stakeholders meetings, and that's where the CDRH will open up to everybody who is involved on some level, everybody who is affected by regulations. They have big meetings where they invite everybody in, and they want to hear from people so that we can help to draft the regulations, help to make sure that they are reasonable and so forth. So we have also published several articles, and all of this is actually available on our website. And most recently, we have compiled all of this information into a single kind of report, special report that we will give you for free. Just send an email to safety@pangolin.com and we will make sure that you receive that. So so Pangolin's really not all about products, all about sales. We're really, just as Greg was talking about earlier today, about giving out the information and making sure people have great information. On our website, you'll see that there's a section here called Laser Resources. And the laser resources, this is all of the things that are available at the laser resources. Safety part of the laser resources is the largest part. There are a number of articles here. Here's an article on laser audience scanning that I wrote in 1997. It's been updated a couple of times since then. One of the things Greg may be getting into is how we have established that you can measure a static beam, 10 milliwatts per square centimeter, how that, along with a scan and fail safeguard, can make sure that the rest of the show is safe. Greg will be going into that. At the very bottom of this article, we derive how it is that we get there. And this is a confusing thing to many people, and so if you're confused after you leave this class, you're really in great hands with Greg here, but if you're confused after you leave this class, you might want to check out that article there. We also have John O'Hagan's whole... He made a whole doctoral thesis about audience scanning and how it can be done safely. That's available right at the website as well, 100% free. There's no login or anything else. You can access this information at any time you want. Article Patrick and I wrote about lasers and aviation safety. There's, in fact, two articles up there, and these are the most two quote articles in this field. We have been contacted by numerous airline pilot association magazines and that sort of thing, and they wind up quoting these articles that are here, and even using some of the pictures and the graphs that were derived for that. And I know this is specific to the United States, but there is something up here that was written by one of our UK members, and it is an entire generic safety policy, a risk assessment, and a contract that you wind up giving your prospective people who you do with, for whom you do laser shows, and so it's all up there, and just download it. You can modify it to your own company and then just use it for free. So we also have, on as part of our laser chat forum, an entire safety section. So if you have any questions about laser safety, you can actually post them on the forum and get answers by the, by safety professionals. So I won't take up any more of your time. I'll hand you over to Greg here. I'd only ask that when it comes time to give some consideration to who it is that's going to control your laser projectors, that you give some consideration to Pangolin, because I think that we've demonstrated some clear leadership and innovation in the field of laser safety. So thank you very much.